quadjacks.com, and I am sitting here with Alan the Anonymous Bari, because Alan Bari has said goodbye to the poker world, right? But now he's back.
I never said goodbye to the poker world.
But it was like this this message that was delivered on Twitter and everywhere, that on Facebook, because I follow you on Facebook.
Yeah,
you stopped playing poker professionally?
No, tournaments.
Tournaments.
I still play cash games one day a week, pretty much.
Right, but the old grinder, the guy who plays every live tournament, that's the Alan Bari of the past.
It's over.
So why are you here then? Because this is where you play tournaments, so explain us.
I only came out for 2.5 weeks. I played 6 tournaments. I got fucked. Can I curse?
Yeah, go ahead.
I got fucked in one. I got ninth. I was second in chips with 14 people left. Mm-hmm. With a lot of chips. It wasn't like I was shallow, but yeah.
Can you share with us how you got fucked in that event? What hand did you bust?
I raised queen 10. It was six-handed, so I raised queen 10, and 4 people called me. Eric Lindgren called next act, and it came 10-10-5, 2 diamonds. Mm-hmm. So I flopped trips.
Yeah.
I bet, and he called. The turn was a 4.
Uh-huh.
I bet, and he called.
Yeah.
And there was an ace of diamonds completing the flush.
Yeah.
And I bet big. I bet 280,000 with like 270 back. Mm-hmm. And he shoved,
mm-hmm.
and I folded after thinking for a long time. And he told me he had aces.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that hand was pretty brutal. But after that, like, I just was crippled. So, whatever, it happens.
Right.
That's just why I don't want to play tournaments anymore.
Right.
You play good. You know, like, you're patient and you play good, you make, you know, good plays.
Right.
And then at the end, it's just like a couple things go wrong.
Have you not made yet your peace with variance? Are you still not accepting variance in its total?
Yeah, I accept variance, and that's why I'm not playing pro tournaments as much anymore.
Uh-huh.
I think that's the perfect acceptance of it. If you're not willing to deal with how absurd tournaments are,
right.
then you leave. So. Uh-huh.
How much more absurd is tournament variance in comparison to what people believe how big variance is, in your opinion?
I think it's a lot worse than people think. Like, I think the poker world's a joke because people say, oh, he's had a sick year, and so they think that these people are good.
Mm-hmm.
I think you could have like a sick 5 years and you're not good yet.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 10 years, a sick 10 years, you might not even be good yet.
Mm-hmm.
I think one day someone will come around and they'll say you need to be like successful for 30 years maybe before you're proven as a good poker player.
Mm-hmm.
So,
what do you think is a good sample size of live tournaments in order to say someone is better than average or has this and that ROI?
I don't know. I'm not smart when it comes to that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell when someone's good just based on playing with them,
mm-hmm.
you know? You can tell, like, if they gain a lot of their chips through, you know, winning flips, or whether they gain a lot of chips, like, without showdown.
Mm-hmm.
There's a big difference in those skill sets,
mm-hmm.
you know? And you can tell that someone's good
mm-hmm.
by the way they accumulate chips.
Who's one of those guys that can accumulate chips without showdowns, in your opinion?
Vanessa Selps.
Yeah.
Jason, my friend Jason.
Jason Mercier.
Although he wins a lot of flips. Who else?
Phil Ivey, maybe?
No.
No? Why not Phil Ivey?
Whatever, I don't want to talk about him. He's good, but like, I think he's an anomaly in poker. I think he's has so many fundamental leaks that it's weird. I think he's a phenomenal poker player. I'm just saying, like, I think he does so many other weird things that counteract all of the...
Right.
Like, fundamental mistakes he
mm-hmm.
makes.
Mm-hmm. So he doesn't make technical mistakes in poker, but
yeah, like
he makes that good with his soul reads.
His soul reads, like, his presence at the table is like nothing compared to anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
He has just a good sense of weakness for strength.
Okay.
But he just doesn't understand that it's, like, bad to flat with, like, 25 blinds with his hand. You know what
yeah.
I'm saying? Or, like, you just can't be... You can't be good enough to know... You can't be good enough to win the pot without flopping a hand more often than you're wasting the blind that you're calling the raise with. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know if that was
Yeah, clear, that makes sense to all our poker strategic
viewers. I don't care if it makes sense to them.
No, that sounds very good. But you played with him probably quite a bit, so
yeah.
you know how his table presence is.
His table
so can you give us an impression of how does he sit there? What is so intimidating?
It's just like he doesn't talk. Now he talks more because he has Ivy Poker, but... Last year in the 5K stud 8 with like 3 tables left, he got moved to my immediate right. And it's just like he's taller and like he has a body presence.
Mm-hmm.
And then he has, like, a chip handling presence, you know what I'm saying?
Chip handling presence.
Yeah, like, the way he handles his chips.
The way he puts them in the middle?
The way he handles his cards. He doesn't talk much. Mm. You know, he just, like, handles his business, and it's weird. Yeah. It's very...
He has a disregard for chips, for money. Is that part of it?
That's not really it. It's just, like, when he gets moved to your table, you can feel it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, you feel it.
Does everyone feel it at the table? Do you feel that everyone feels it?
Yes, everyone feels it.
Immediately?
You feel it and everyone feels it, and you feel that everyone feels it.
So that automatically means that everyone plays a little bit worse against him?
I think people either play worse or they... People either play looser or they play tighter against him, and I think that he's good at adjusting to this guy playing looser, mm-hmm. this guy playing tighter. Like, people either call more against him or they fold more against mm-hmm. him, and I think that he quickly picks up on who folds more, who calls more, and then adjusts.
Mm-hmm.
So this guy folds more, he's going to bluff him more. If this guy mm-hmm. calls more, he's going to bluff him less.
Yeah. That's a good old soul read that we're talking about, right?
Exactly.
But, now, the one question is, Phil Ivey is one of the top winners.
Was this a Phil Ivey interview or an Alan Barry interview?
We're going to come to the Alan Barry part after this, but he's also the top winner online in online poker history.
Yeah.
So there is no I mean, there are soul reads in online poker, but he's sitting behind the computer. So how can he win there with all those fundamental leaks?
Because he's usually playing heads up. And in heads up, those fundamental leaks aren't as and he's deeper. You know, like, I think most of his fundamental leaks are like 30 blinds and less.
Yeah.
You're never 30 blinds or less in a cash game.
Right.
So.
Good answer. Alan Barry is better than Phil Ivey, and he won a bracelet in 2000.
I'm not better than Phil
Ivey. But I'm saying this right now with all the conviction.
No, see, this is the thing. Like, this is why I'm quitting poker. Not quitting, but like, I'm playing less tournaments, is because they're tough.
Yeah.
They're not like they used to be. You know, I used to think I was the best. I still think I'm good, but tournaments are too tough, and they're too tough to beat. So it's time to leave and do other mm-hmm. things, and mm-hmm. maybe poker will get softer in the future.
But we all hope so. To what degree would you call yourself still a professional poker player or not?
I mean, right now I'm surviving off poker. You know, I mm-hmm. play once a week, and that's how I pay for all of my stuff.
Mm.
But I would say I'm semi-professional right now. I'm hoping to be completely semi to non-professional at all mm-hmm. within the next 8 to 10 months. So.
What games are you usually playing when you play once a week?
I play like 75-150 HOE, so Hold'em, Omaha, and 8 or better.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's usually a bigger game at night, like 5-6 p.m. We play like 153-36 at Parks mm-hmm. Casino in Philadelphia. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Can you share with us, all those people out there that might confront the same situation where they want to stop their poker career and try to do something solid? Since you stopped playing, did you feel any changes in your personal happiness? Do you feel more release?
I feel happier.
What is an example?
I feel less stressed. Just a lot of things. When you're spending more time with people, like your true friends. I mean, I have a lot of friends in poker, mm-hmm. and they're definitely my close friends. But I'm just saying, like, these are my friends that I met in life rather than poker. Like, I feel like you're happier. You know, there's less stress because you don't have to... When you play cash games, it's less stressful because you win 80% of the time if you're good, mm. you know? So rather than being unhappy 99% of the time, like in tournaments,
mm-hmm.
you're happy 80% of the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and you win like a couple thousand, you go home. It's a good day.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything about the online, the tournament poker circuit, like traveling it, seeing different cities, something that you miss a lot since you stopped?
Yeah, I mean, I miss my friends. I miss going deep in tournaments. Like, it's the greatest feeling in the world when you have a lot of chips and you go deep in a tournament.
Right.
And, like, you play cool hands against other strong players. Mm. You know, hands that involve a lot of, you know, leveling and stuff like that. I miss cool hands, you know, like, playing cool hands and knowing what this guy thinks I know and, you know,
right.
taking advantage of that. Mm-hmm. But besides that, I don't really miss traveling, you know, traveling all over Europe is very expensive, and it really drains you. I like home. I really, really like home. I like my friends at home. I like I like my fiance. I like my dog. I like my apartment. I like my town. I like my family. I got good stuff at home. So
sounds like there are no regrets.
Yeah. No, I'm very happy. I miss poker. You know, I still watch poker.
Yeah.
You know, like PokerStars.tv, whenever they release a new episode of EPTs, I watch it right away. And
QuadJacks.com as well.
QuadJacks.com too.
The live streams that we do and all the interviews.
I love QuadJacks.com. So good.
Thank you so much, buddy. No, thank you for this interview. I know that you actually had plans to go for dinner, which I kind of ruined right now.
45 minutes. I have to shower, dress, and charge my phone.
Okay. Oh, yeah, I charge your phone right now, actually.
Yeah,
it should be done.
I need
right
more
now
than that. I need it fully juiced for the rest of the day.
Okay, then I'll let you run right now and let your telephone charge.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alan, for this interview, and good luck for the future.
Thank you.
QuadJacks.com.